Okay, well, I was supposed to be here with John Lloyd of the Reuters Institute, and he's a stern task. He's interviewing Italian journalists at the moment in Rome to write a book about the current state of world journalism. So, alas, you'll have to do that, John Lloyd. But I want to thank him first, because I wouldn't have written this pamphlet without him, because you're made a fellow at the Reuters Institute of Journalism, and they encourage you to come up with topics, and my topics were all completely hopeless, until he said, well, all your topics are hopeless, they're far too obscure, they sound like French books that never got published, and why don't you just write something about documentaries? And I never had, and I never would have done, and I got a lot out of it, and I've got to say thanks to him. The other person I have to thank specifically, I'll thank generically everyone who works with me at the BBC. Too many people to mention, but I want to thank especially Jo Lapping, who put together this clip reel, Come on the Clip Reel, and she's done it in a very clever way. I would never have done it so well myself, because she knows the rather bizarre aspects of my taste. So the clip reel is a sort of desert island doc selected by her and not by me, but I will talk to it. Okay, there are essentially two things in this pamphlet. The first thing is that I became aware that documentaries had gotten better and better and better. That here was I sitting watching many documentaries on behalf of the BBC, and the count of wonderful documentaries rose like that each year. There were more exciting documentaries, more wonderful documentaries, and this was sort of happening without anyone realizing it. Suddenly, after, you know, decades in the doldrums, decades of boringness, of normality, of absence, of routine, documentaries became very hot and very interesting. And this was picked up much faster, I have to say, by the likes of Leonardo DiCaprio or, you know, Hollywood celebrities than it was by broadcasters. So, having intuited the existence of these wonderful documentaries and sitting at the BBC watching them, I then found myself curiously in a situation of being a kind of representative from the outside, inside a broadcaster, telling the broadcasters the whole time, look, these are great films. And to my great gratitude, the BBC actually listened to me. They began to increase the number of slots, you know, and they began to take the form more seriously. Now, you never do this in Britain, really. You never are able to get up in public in Britain and say, look, this is a cultural form that matters. It really matters. I had professor friends in the 70s, like Colin McCabe, who used to talk about cultural forms. If you do that in the BBC, you're destined for non-promotion, which was fine by me because I didn't want to be promoted, didn't want to join the ranks of the superstructure of the BBC. I was happy looking after these films. But the films got better and better. And I noticed, however, as they got better, the funding capability of documentaries did not improve in proportion to the excellence of documentaries. So what this pamphlet addresses, I think, is a sort of yawning gap that gets wider each year now between the potential of documentaries, which is not fulfilled in two ways. It's not fulfilled. Firstly, it's not fulfilled in terms of funding, so that documentary filmmakers on the whole, extremely poor. And secondly, it's not fulfilled because documentaries are not getting to as many people as they should get to. They ought to be watched, they ought reasonably to be watched by about 10 times as many people as actually watch them month on month, year on year. And it's not happening. So the pamphlet addresses that. So I wouldn't call it quite a crisis. I would say we're in a sort of pre-crisis mode of documentary funding and documentaries. It's going to get worse. And my impulse in writing this pamphlet was to say, well, it needn't get worse. So I would like, however, to discuss this with you at the end of the presentation, because since we don't have too much time, what I'd far rather do is take you through this clip reel, which, as I said, are my sort of desert island docs. And I could have done four clip reels like this. What you're seeing just happens to be a slice of my own experience as a documentary obsessive, but yeah, there could even be eight slices like this, or 10. So I don't claim I don't claim to be dogmatically certain about the excellence of what you're about to see, because that, in a way, is the whole point of documentaries. There's so many wonderful ones, and they impress us in so many different ways. They're like a giant menagerie that's somehow becoming a species. You know, they'll never become a species, but we ought to think of them as a species. They'll stay a menagerie full of huge, small, unpleasant, pleasant animals that require a lot of attention and that are very rewarding in spite of all their flaws. So that's the way I think of documentaries, and they've pleased me a lot and will continue to please me much more, I have to tell you, than fiction films, which I think have gone down the chutes in recent years, and that documentaries have somehow, in a rather touching way, become far more important. Okay, now I'm going to start by showing you a clip of a remarkable man. The only really mad thing this man did was to try to make France teetotal. He's called Pierre Mendès France. He was a brilliant Jewish centrist prime minister of France who got France out of Vietnam. 5 stars for that. And the first clip recounts a very interesting moment in his life. So can we see the first clip, please?
Je dois dire que je ne suis pas très sportif, mais enfin, je m'étais préparé à cette épreuve en faisant pas mal de gymnastique dans les mois précédents. Et me voilà donc en haut du mur, j'avais à sauter, c'était assez haut, mais il fallait prendre le risque. Et puis, une fois sauté, bien, j'étais en liberté avec tout ce qui devait suivre. Au moment où je vais sauter, il y avait des arbres plantés là le long de l'avenue. J'entends un bruit... inattendu, des voix, j'essaye de voir dans la demi-obscurité. Et il y avait un couple sous l'arbre et vous pouvez imaginer l'objet de leur conversation. Et lui avait des idées très précises, elle n'était pas décidée. Et ça m'a paru très long. Elle a fini par dire oui, mais vraiment, j'ai eu l'impression d'une très longue résistance. Et ils sont partis, alors j'ai sauté. Mais moi, en haut de mon... Je vous promets, j'étais plus content, plus heureux que moi. Je voudrais bien la rencontrer une fois, ça me ferait plaisir de lui dire combien j'ai vécu avec ce couple, cette soirée-là et cette nuit-là.
Combien son audace vous faisait plaisir.
Et combien son manque d'audace à elle me paraissait intempestif. L'amour, la chance, l'évasion, finalement, l'ont emporté.
Okay, have the lights on, yeah. I went to see The Sorrow and the Pity in, I think it was 1970, with my French mother, who'd spent the occupation years in a small village in Normandy. And I didn't know what this was. I didn't know what a documentary was. And the film lasts close to 5 hours. And it was the most extraordinary experience, because after about an hour, after you got past the humiliation of the French defeat in 1940, I noticed that people were hissing around me, that there were intakes of breath and people were furious. And I suddenly had an idea about halfway through the film, is that, you know, this is something very remarkable here. You should do films like this. You should do films that sort of crack open subjects like that and make people confront things about their lives that they don't necessarily want to think about. And what I also liked about the film, which, by the way, is Woody Allen's favorite film, those of you who've seen Annie Hall may remember there's a fantastic allusion to The Sorrow and the Pity. They're queuing outside and they have a conversation about it. And what I really liked about the film is the sort of preservation of characters like Pierre Mendès France, who talks about these immensely public, these immensely painful subjects in a very funny way. And I've shown you this because that's what put me on the track of documentaries, that they tell you interesting things, but they tell you things in a kind of informal, unquantifiable way. They're miles away from political science. They're miles away from official discourse. And they can be very entertaining while they're being very serious at the same time. So The next clip, however, we will show, does not require any introduction at all. Let's have the lights up. Okay. In 1944, when George Orwell was given the reviews of Animal Farm, he read them and he said, but they didn't say how beautiful it was. And I didn't see this film actually till way into the 70s, but the most astonishing thing about this film is, it seems to come from nowhere. It is the fact that they invented the Pennybakers making this film. They invented a whole genre of music. They did more than that. They understood popular culture in the 1960s. The film is full of wonderful insights about the shabbiness of Britain when Dylan arrived there, and Dylan looks like a Martian, you know, arrived in black and white in North Britain, hanging around Manchester, hanging around the Granada studios, encountering representatives of what was then called Tin Pan Alley. And then in the middle of this, you have this scene to me that is quite startlingly beautiful with Joan Baez, who is then his item, by the way. They were an item. And what I love about it is the way he starts typing, you know, and you can't tell when you're looking at the film whether the typing is rhythmical, it's a homage to Joni, or more likely, it's a sign that genius is a capacity for taking, you know, infinite pains, and he's switched off, he's thinking about his own poetry, and that's what he's really like. So I think it's very beautiful, and I think there have been a whole line of wonderful documentaries like this that deal with popular culture, many of them made by the Pennybakers, and they've never really received enough credit. I mean, we know about Magnum photos, we know about still photos of the Beatles, Rolling Stones, Bob Dylan, but films like this have never quite gotten their due, and they are really important, in my view. Well, we're going to skip a bit. The rest of the films bring us up into the 80s and 90s, and what I'd think of as the, you know, what we're going through at the moment, which is a very remarkable age of making documentaries. And I picked the next one that I'll tell you a bit about, which is a film about the Munich Olympics by Kevin MacDonald. And has anyone seen One Day in September? Yeah, all right. The film was roundly trashed on, I think it was, what was it called then, The Late Show or The Review, by Tom Nairn, who loathed the film, and also Edward Said, who took quite violent exception to the film, because I think wrongly they thought it was a Zionist film, a very pro-Israeli film, and I think they were under a misapprehension as the nature of documentaries. I think that people come to political films or journalistic films of this kind with an expectation that they must be balanced, because that's the way films were made for so long. They would try to give you, not always very well, both sides of the story. And I think what happened, one of the things that happened, and I could actually instance Brian Lapping's films as an example of this, but I just took this. Like I said, I could have another. My next 10 films would contain at least two of Brian Lapping's films in it, so it's coincidence, it's not there. But people started to look at political films, for better or for worse, in a different way. They focused more on what really happened, they could do that because the technology was available. You could film much more, but they could also do that because by the time a film like this was made, it was half spun off from television. The regulations of television, which, you know, enjoin you to be very balanced, very responsible, very self-effacing, had partly disappeared. They still existed inside television, but films like this were funded and made half outside television. And I think that gave a startling freedom. It was the moment, really, when pioneers like the Penny Bakers, like Maisels, like Marcel Ofields, like indeed like Lanzmann, Claude Lanzmann, when their ideas went into the mainstream and documentaries suddenly became much more ambitious, more polemical, but also in this instance, they became more about trying to forget about interpretation, forget about analysis. Let's try to plunge you in the middle of what really happened and leave it to you to figure out what you think about that. So let's see the next clip.
They have now said that there were 11 hostages. Two were killed in their rooms yesterday morning. 9 were killed at the airport tonight. They're all gone.
Okay, well, a lot of people hated this, but I didn't, and I didn't really care, actually, if people were going to say that it was Zionist propaganda, as I said, because he didn't really need an encouraging, Kevin, because he made the film more, every cut, he made them feel more emotional, more in your face, and you might take exception with that. The editor, you know, a lot of this would seem, you know, a lot of people have done that since. The editor came from doing commercials, and I thought that was a very good thing too, and I really liked the film, which unexpectedly to me went on to win an Oscar. I think unexpectedly to Kevin as well, and it still seems to me to be a very good film. If you are trying to tell people, almost in a non-political way, what an act of terrorism is like, this is what happens, this is what happens to people who are, what happens to people who are murdered, but the people around them, well, you might as well pick the Munich Olympics and you might as well tell the story in as great, as impassioned detail as you can. And I think the film is much more appealing than the Spielberg film that's rather talky and rather dull and actually full of rather pseudo-moral considerations. It's got a sort of slick overlay of Hollywood non-moral considerations about significance of film, whereas this is much more visceral, to me, more interesting, more immediate. Right. Anyway, this is after this film, shortly after, I then find myself in the midst of documentary heaven at the BBC because the stuff kept pouring in. I haven't actually got a clip of Hoop Dreams, Steve James' stuff. I would have that in my next 10 great moments. But what I've chosen to show you instead is a Werner Herzog film. And notoriously, Werner Herzog is prone to get up in public and say how much he hates documentaries. He hates documentaries, but all his best work is a form of documentary. And he hates fly-on-the-wall films. He has a real obsession about fly-on-the-wall films. Somehow he thinks hanging around and recording stuff is awful. And he's matured into a sort of bizarre combination of Nietzsche and Alan Wicker. He runs around the world in search of awful extreme situations out of which he conjures great work. And he has a theme which is essentially, you know, he's a German, about the awfulness of human beings, but also the awfulness of nature. The way we sentimentalize nature and the way basically the world we live in is disgusting. But at the same time, there's a grandiose vision of the beauty of nature. And in this film, Little Dieter Needs to Fly, a vision of the capability of humans to survive awful things. And we'll get the clip, but you have to know about Little Dieter. The most important thing about him is in the style of the hero of my favorite recent British novel, Empire of the Sun, he grew up watching American planes flying at 50 feet above, you know, the village at huge speed, about to go and destroy things. And he became a pilot in the Vietnam War because he wanted to fly planes very fast. He had no ideological interest in American power or American imperialism. He didn't care much about American democracy. He just wanted to fly planes very fast, and he was shot down over Vietnam, tortured by the Pathet Lao. And Werner's, to me, totally astonishing film is about taking him back among the relatives, people like the people who tortured him. And Dieter Dengler, his name is a middle-aged, broken German who went through this kind of hell and who somehow very touchingly survived it and remained a sentient human being. And Werner later turned this wonderful documentary into a feature film that I didn't like at all. Obviously, I didn't like it, but this is a scene out of it. Okay.
You know, it was natural for them to be really angry at me now. I had escaped from them, they had lost face, and they really wanted to get even. Whenever we near the village, that's when they really became aggressive. They had this new idea. My legs were tied up, my arms were tied up, my hands were tied up. I was tied behind the water buffalo. They hit the water buffalo with a stick, it started taking off. I was hopping behind it. I was trying to keep my balance, but pretty soon I fell over. A couple, two or three of the guards, the bad ones, kept walking to the right and left. They were kicking me in the face with the dust all the time. They were kicking me. Other guys would jump into my back. The kids were laughing. They thought it was just as a lot of fun. Later on, they wanted me to sign something condemning the American aggression in Vietnam. I didn't sign it. I didn't believe in it. They came up with this idea. They stuck small little pieces of bamboo underneath my fingernails. They cut my arms. They put pieces of bamboo. Actually, they stuck it in there and they left a piece of bamboo in there. They cut here, they cut here, they cut here, at various different places. Then one guy had this idea, they put this rope around my upper arm, like a tourniquet. They put a piece of wood in there and twisted it until the nerves were cut against the bone. My hand would drop and this hand was completely unusable for 6 months. They were just always thinking of something to do to me.
Two things to say about this film that I love very much. It never really was shown at festivals because people didn't like, well, they didn't like the fact that he was an American imperialist and a German American imperialist, and it sunk. It would not have won the Oscar. It in my view, it's one of his very best films. The other thing, a lot of people didn't like these sort of set up retrospective interviews. They thought they were too close to dramatization. And that's really Werner's point. Werner's point is that you want to tell the truth about something, you just utilize any means you have. If the film has a conviction of being true, even if the means of telling the truth are not literally truthful, in other words, I don't think Werner would care if some of the details of his account were not strictly accurate. I never had the nerve to ask Werner how much of these interviews were actually scripted by Werner rather than Dieter Dengler. I mean, I had a feeling that they were, but I didn't ask him. And I don't really have a problem with this. I don't think this film isn't in the business of recording truth about Dengler's life, but none of us can check whether his life unrolled in exactly the way he says it does. And I really don't think it matters. And I think it's very creative, this business of on-the-spot retrospection. I think when you force people into a situation where they have to talk about their past, however you do it, if it results in something quite as extraordinary as that, it's great. There's another scene, of course, exactly like this, in a film I should have showed you a clip of. I think it was a choice between that and Sorrow and the Pity, and that's in Shoah, where there is about a 20-minute interview of someone cutting hair in a hair salon in Tel Aviv and recounting the fact his job was to cut the hair of people he knew just before they were taken in the gas chambers. And he recounts in great detail, and poignant detail, unbearable detail, how one day when he was going about his business, enforced by the people running the camp, of course, the Germans, there were women from his village, and he found himself cutting the hair of people he knew in the full knowledge, which they did not share, that they were going to be killed 5 minutes later. And I really admire, that seems to me truly creative, documentaries like that, that have something so badly they want to tell you about some kind of truth that they will resort to quite creative means to tell you. The next clip is a weird clip by Errol Morris, another filmmaker I like very much, and he uses all. He's the opposite of verite filmmaking, but I chose this clip actually because it offered a very oblique commentary on the current public crisis of our times, which is that of tabloid journalism. That is, how much of what we're told in the popular press actually is totally invented. In tabloid, Errol Morris took a totally preposterous story about the kidnapping and the forced sex, I think you'd call it, of a Mormon in a Dorset hotel. And he tells the story in such astonishing detail that by the end of the film, you are more uncertain about the story than you were at the beginning of the film. And I think this is a very interesting commentary. You know, it's not what the Leveson Inquiry is about. They're supposed to be responsible and ascertain the crimes of the tabloid press. But in fact, the reality of the tabloid press and the reason we got to where we are in relation to the tabloid press is that we collude with clever, popular journalists in the creation of contemporary fictions. And frankly, we don't give a damn whether these are fictions or non-fictions. I think tabloid is a very entertaining film. So let's see the clip of that.
So you drive up in your rental car with KJ.
I waited, and KJ went in, because they're not supposed to be in the room alone with girls, so KJ went in and said, Joyce is in the car. And Kirk turned around and he threw the keys to his companion and said, I've got to go out in the car and get something. I'll be right back.
So he goes out with KJ.
Yeah. And didn't come back. And this poor old dumb companion's sitting there staring like he's catching flies, looking at the window waiting for him to come back. He got in the car and he goes, how long have you been in England? Like a robot. He was almost speaking in a monotone voice and he go, they said you didn't love me anymore. It was like he had a personality alteration. Kirk number one and Kirk number two. Kirk number one was the man I fell in love with. Kirk number two was cult Kirk.
Mm-hmm.
according to all the reports of the time, he was driven 250 miles to a cottage in Devon. She had a suitcase full of all the equipment required, including, I gather, some Los Angeles Police Department Smith & Wesson handcuffs. He was taken in and chained to... Joyce claims it was ropes, not chains, but chain sounds better. Anyway, he was allegedly chained to a bed, first by his ankle, so that he could actually reach the toilet. The chain was long enough for him to get to the toilet. Subsequently, with the help of Keith May, was spread-eagled, which is a wonderful bondage word, was spread-eagled to the bed. And Keith May discreetly left the room at this point, I think, closed the door behind him, and Joyce had sex with him. And she said to him she was going to go on having sex with him until she found she missed a period and would then hopefully be pregnant by him.
She wanted to be inseminated?
Yes, I think that's the polite word for it.
I start a critical note enters my remarks here because I think these kind of films are wonderful. By the way, Errol Morris invented this camera called, I think it's called, you probably know, the animatron, and it's capable of taking shots of people. He shoots one interview and it, I don't know, it takes five different angles. But look, it's very, very hard to get films like this made in Britain. I mean, Errol makes a ton of money shooting commercials in America, and he's got a huge backlog of work to show for. At the moment, he's busy, very entertainingly for me, doing a film with and about Donald Rumsfeld. I like Fog of War about McNamara very much, but I really can't wait for Errol's film about Donald Rumsfeld, because no doubt, apart from telling us about the Bush administration that we all want to know so much more about in our lives, it will tell us about Donald Rumsfeld's bizarre penchant for Greco-Roman wrestling. you can see it coming, which is what I think he did it. I'm sure Brian would remember. I think it was at Yale that Donald Rumsfeld was a great Greco-Roman wrestler. And I would say, look, we do a good job in this country of funding documentaries, but if a tiny portion of the money that goes into creating tabloid television were removed and given to the certain people in the audience here, we would be able to make more films like this, make more films which are ironical, clever, subtle, humorous, and don't have any raison d'etre. They're not self-evidently pointing to the evils of the world. They just want to tell us entertaining things, and that's what Errol has done for the past 20 years, and we'll go on doing it. Okay, well, getting near the present, I wanted to show you a piece of this film about bare-knuckle fist-fighting involving tribes of travellers in Ireland, Cool Knuckle, which the filmmaker Ian Palmer spent 10 years doing. I mean, he was invited to chronicle the weddings of travellers, and he became involved in this bizarre feud out of which he made this film. I mean, you know, he was a sort of wedding photographer, and he spent all this time making the film. And I think the fate of the film is very interesting because it did quite well in cinemas in Ireland, though they had to be very careful where they showed it because the travellers otherwise would arrive and break up the furniture in the cinema. But in addition to that, it was acquired, this is really interesting, by HBO, who didn't want to show the film because you'll understand immediately when you see the clip why they weren't going to show the film in America. But they've turned it with the author of Trainspotting into a drama based on fact. And the idea is that there is bare-knuckle fist-fighting somewhere in America, like in Pennsylvania. And what really interests me, there's no evidence since the 18th century of these things going on in America. It's a fiction. But the fiction is more appealing than this. I think what I loved about the film was that it did actually, apart from being an astonishing sort of anti-Irish tourist board film. I mean, you watch this film, you say, I never go to an Irish village in my life. It did sort of recreate what Britain must have been like in the 18th century, where you can see a village, and outside the village there's a little circle of people. There are lots of dogs, skinny dogs, fat dogs, all kinds of dogs, and lots of children. And in the middle of a ring of people, two enormous men are busy beating the shit out of each other. And can we see the clip, please?
Has decided to put a few photos at the start of this tape of Brian and Tim, the two men who were willfully murdered by the Queen MacDonald.
As the train pulls out today from Derby.
The Joyce family from Oxford sent this tape to the Queen MacDonald's. The families had been close friends until 1992. Then a row outside a pub in Peckham got out of hand and Brian Joyce was killed. Brian was the brother-in-law of Big Joe, and James's older brother Curly Paddy was convicted of manslaughter. He served 18 months in prison. During the feud that followed, another man from the Joyce family called Timmy was killed in Dublin in 1996.
Hey, look, them is the men. Them is the men that ye killed from behind. You cowardly pack of bollocks. Kiss my Joyce's horn. And then one more thing. If there's an Aaron Quinn that'll match up to me, I will gladly fight him. And I gladly beat him. You dirty pack of cowardly murdering bastards. This is the real legend, James. You baldy bollocks.
Jimmy's Mike. You said there was never a Joyce any good. I ain't no good anyway, but I'm beating you. I see you baldy James. About 10 years' time, I'm going to beat you the length of Ireland. Yeah, so see that man, I see that man there. You'll never beat him. He is the man.
Yeah, dirty bollocks.
Jimmy's Michael, just listen to my words. Listen. I am beating you and every one of your brothers and your people. I am beating the Queens.
Big Paul Joyce, the young man on the Oxford tape, got the fight he was looking for against Michael Quinn MacDonald. Michael was now 19 years old, the youngest in his family. Up to this point, I'd seen him as the cheerleader for his big brother. He told me that if he was challenged, he'd fight for the family name. But I thought Michael was in the shadow of his older brother, and I saw a young man who wanted to make a name for himself.
I think it's interesting, which brings me on to something we can discuss later, that these sort of films are self-evidently made with great difficulty. That is, that the film had been hanging around Ireland, and RTE, the public broadcaster, were very uncertain what to do about it, and it had been pitched to the Irish Film Board, and then a producer brought it to us, and we thought, well, this is a good idea. So when we managed to invest in it, that made the Irish Film Board happy, because they require a broadcaster in order to fund things. And we love working with them, and the editing went very well with the British director, Ollie Huddleston, who's just great. And there was about 500 hours of material of this stuff, you know, a lot. And what then happened, that once we sort of got into it, then it went back into RTE and they were agreed to show it. So it had a very, as you might imagine, a very large rating in Ireland. And, you know, all in all, the film has been very successful. I mean, it can't fully recommend some the director for 10 years of work, but it sort of worked very well in the end. You can do these deals now. They take a lot of time. The sums of money are very small, and you have to work very hard to do the deals because it's difficult, but this was a success. The next clip was as a kind of homage to John Lloyd, who's not here, because it's about journalism, but it's a film that I liked. It's not a perfect film, but it's a film about the degree to which reporting is under threat, and it takes the New York Times as its subject. But in fact, It's about the people at the New York Times who write about the decline of the New York Times, i.e. the media desk, and it contains this quite remarkable man who in previous times I would have urged everyone to go out and make a long series with him, David Carr, who is an ex-crack addict. Very unusual that New York Times employs ex-crack addicts. It's a very stuffy place, the New York Times. And he writes these completely brilliant elegiac columns or satirical columns about the follies, the stupidities, but the sort of tragic aspects of the vanishing of print journalism and the way it's not actually being replaced by anything that quite measures up to what it was capable of doing. And that's what the film is about. I should tell you also that the film was roundly disliked by the New York Times itself. And they arranged for the film to be reviewed by someone who was bound to dislike it. So it was trashed in the columns of the New York Times. Mysteriously to me, I think it had to do with their office politics, because on the whole, it's a very good account of the way they work. So let's just see a clip of that.
It's a big story that hasn't really been told in this kind of comprehensive way. The biggest media bankruptcy in history, billions and billions of dollars just evaporated. A lot of people lost their jobs.
The people there are still doing, you know, excellent work, but it's under very difficult circumstances from people who manifestly do not respect what they do.
Sam Zell, when he came in, was somebody with no experience running a company like this, no news experience, in fact, a fair bit of contempt for sort of traditional ideas of journalism.
My attitude on journalism is very simple. I want to make enough money so I can afford you. It's really that simple, okay? You need to, in effect, help me by being a journalist that focuses on what our readers want.
But what readers want are puppy dogs. I mean, we also need to inform the community.
I'm sorry. I can't, you're giving me the classic, what I would call, journalistic arrogance.
You know, people inside just sort of get dispirited because the company's being run by these people who just don't share their values.
Hopefully we get to the point where our revenue is so significant that we can do puppies and a rat, okay? Fuck you.
Sam Zell wanted to put Randy Michaels, whom he knew from the radio business, in charge of Tribune Company. Michaels then came in, and one of the first things he worked on was rewriting the company's ethics policy to basically say, we're going to be in a much more permissive atmosphere, and, you know, it's going to be creative, and there's going to be things that offend you.
You know what's important to the people who buy advertising? I don't mean the agencies. I mean the people who write the checks. They want to sell widgets. They want to move product. They want the cash register to ring. They want butts and seats.
Some people are like, we need something. So this could be as good as any. I mean, it's a kind of, it's a sort of crazy Hail Mary pass. So these guys come in, bought the company. This is how they behaved. This is the result.
This company, they drove it into bankruptcy. Randy Michaels and a handpicked crew of 20 people who he's known a long, long time have extracted something like $100 million in bonuses. You could call that incentives or you could call that looting, depending on your perspective.
Okay, just an interesting footnote to this film, which, as I said, I think it's a very good, fair-minded film about contemporary journalism, is it was picked up by someone called Jeff Skoll, who was one of the founders of eBay, and who has I think you'd best describe a series of branded activities and companies called Participant. He has a company that does profit-making, that does kind of worthy entertainment, and he backs films like this because he puts a lot of outreach money into them and runs campaigns around them. I mean, they have to be able to reach people in America, but once that's evident to him, he will back them. And this film was the subject of one of his campaigns, and he wanted to bring to people's attention the failings of contemporary reporting and the way the whole culture of reporting was disappearing. So it did have a impact much larger than it would have otherwise, thanks to one of the new people and new developments in the funding of documentaries. Well, I just got one more clip, and I'll do some questions after that. And I chose this because I think it's quite extraordinary. And I won't say anything about it, except it's a first film. And it's it's something I'll remember for many, many years. Yes, it's about albinos, and that's enough. So let's see the last clip.
Kama leo jamii ilikuwa inaniona kwamba mimi si binadamu na huzunika na tafuta solution. Nawezaje kubadilisha jamii fikiri huyu ni baraka? Na kuna watu ambao wameuawa hawana hatia. Rafiki yangu akakatwa katwa ni kama si na viazi vinanafu. Kwa Wow, wake up. Ni watu tu imejitokeza, watu wachache wamedanganywa kwamba kwenye ngozi yangu humu kuna nini jamani? Kuna mali. Vidole vyangu hivi ukivipata kesho asubuhi wewe ukiamka basi zinazungumza mfukoni. Unaneno wewe dole tofauti yangu iko wapi? Eh? Umeloko hiyo wapi? Halafu nene? Lakini sisi ni binadamu au sio binadamu? Wewe hii ngozi hii ina kitu kimoja kinachoitwa melanin. Sasa hii melanin inasababisha mpaka focus ya kwenye macho yako hii. Sawa? Ikipungua. Sawa? Inaathiri mpaka kwenye nini? Mnanielewa vizuri? Mnaona macho yangu jinsi yalivyo? Mnaona? Wengine wanasema agolidimagawe. Wengine wanasema agolidimagawe. Mimi sio shetani. Kwenu. Jamani, msituue, tutunzeni.
Well, it's sort of like a bit of Shakespeare, isn't it, really? And my last observation is that this... It isn't as if, look, this is a rarely wonderful film, but scenes like this and things like this come through our office very frequently, and there has to be a way that they can be enabled to reach more people in the world. There has to be a way that we can get better at distributing and showing documentaries, not just in this country where it's relatively good, but globally, because when we show documentaries on BBC World News, they're among the best rated programs on BBC World News. They really are. I mean, people love them. And you like to imagine somehow that this scene will get to people all over the world. They'll watch it. There's nothing much they can do once they watch it. They can watch it anywhere in the world. And it will have some impact in the end. And I think the message of my pamphlet is that we have to attend to this. That in a way, nothing will get solved about the penury of documentary filmmakers, the fragility of the genre. It may always be like that. Maybe you can do nothing about that because there are too many people making documentaries. But we have to get better at showing them and get them to people who want to watch them. And that's something I would need your help to do, because in spite of my position in the middle of the largest public media organization in the world, I can't do it alone.
Does anybody have any questions now? Just raise your hand.
Nobody.
Talking about access to documentaries, I mean, I really like Storyville, for example.
Yeah.
I wouldn't know how to, if I miss a Storyville, and if it's gone out of date on iPlayer, there have been dozens and dozens of documentaries shown, I wouldn't know how to access them.
Well, I think that's a very good question. I think that, interestingly, when I compiled the list of 50 documentaries, this pamphlet, all but one of them, and it was one of the Lappings documentaries, was available on Amazon. Sorry?
I'm just thinking, very rude to have someone have me on a phone whilst you're talking.
Oh, who was on the phone?
Who? I'm sorry. I'm really obnoxious, and I think absolutely rude. We're in a presentation of serious discussion, and someone thinks it's more interesting to find out if their sex life is going to happen tonight or not.
Well, yeah. Sex life may be more interesting. Shall we say life is possibly more interesting than the representation of reality? Life is certainly more interesting than art, but documentaries are not art. No, look, you can get many of these shows on Amazon, but that's not good enough. And I think you have to be modest about these things. One of the things I've proposed since been okayed by the BBC, if I can find between $2 and $3 million a year, which is a sort of lunch for an American foundation, the BBC will put upwards of 20 documentaries on BBC World News each year, and they will then go on to a, they go onto the internet for a period of time. But it doesn't entirely answer your question, because the system of distribution is so inefficient it's so diffuse, it's so dispersed that that's just a step in the right direction. That would ensure that loads more people watch documentaries. I think it is a real problem that you don't know where to go to find these things. I mean, if you know about the film, there'll be a website, and you can go there and you can find out where to buy it, or you can find out maybe bits of it on YouTube. But there's no aggregation of things. It's a documentary has never had any coherent identity. They were just things that happened. So they've gone into the age of the internet without any aggregation, without anyone really knowing how to find them. And I think when we did Man on Wire, I got a phone call from Stephen Frears, who really liked the film, and he said, you know, the tragedy of contemporary culture is all the best things, no one knows how to find them, because you had to spend so much money in order to tell people where things are. I mean, realistically, and I've got to stop and take another question, that the only way you can get people to documentaries, in my view, is by very large brands like the BBC. If the BBC is willing to act as a sort of portal within the internet to offer people documentaries to download them for free or to buy them or whatever, if the BBC is part of that, that will improve things a lot. I don't see them quite working just on Amazon, but that's my view. Okay.
Hi.
Back.
Hi, thank you. I'm working with Open City Docs Fest. So I guess you're talking about the internet dissemination or distribution of films. I wonder if you could say maybe something about the cinematic distribution also of documentary, and if you see that as the future as well, or is the internet the future?
Well, I think that the fact that documentary films have been in cinemas is hugely important. But it's important because it's given them a certain profile. In fact, the figures are deplorable. Apart from The March of the Penguins and, Sicko and Fahrenheit 9/11, I mean, the performance of documentaries is just embarrassing. It's so, 5 million at the box office is considered an achievement. And so I think that in the history of what documentaries are, cinema is very important, but I don't see it as a long-term solution to the problems I'm talking about. I see the internet as much more promising. I think actually that it's wonderful that documentaries are things you want to see in a cinema, but in a fundamental way, they're the sort of jokers in the pack of contemporary culture. You can see them however you like. You can see them. It doesn't really matter if the sound quality is not fantastic and the picture quality is not fantastic. They're still just as enjoyable, and they're very good off laptops. So I don't think cinema is essential, though it's wonderful to see a great documentary in a cinema.
What you're discussing in terms of how you're going to capture an audience to watch a documentary. And I'm a still photographer, and I'm mostly post-conflict. And you go in, and not so many years ago, you were dealing with commissionings that were going to be in picture post, or, as I'm a Yank, as you can tell from my accent, whatever magazine. Now we have to look at different outlets and how we're going to get it out there. And one of the most powerful vehicles that most photojournalists are looking at today is the idea of doing exhibitions, which are more, you can say, fine art-y without compromise of integrity of the story that you're telling. And I'm a documentarian. I'm not breaking news and arms and limbs being blown up in war. It's post-conflict. And looking at new ways of presenting your work and which audience you're going to attract. And it's the idea, I think most of us, when we were discussing it the last night, as a matter of fact, at a Jody Bieber event at 8 Gallery, the idea that we have to be very careful how we are attracting an audience. You know, being a filmmaker and being BBC, that's huge.
Well, no, it's not. I think a lot of documentary filmmakers, you can ask some of them here, will quite envy you as a stills photographer, because stills photographers, if they're successful, tend to be much more successful than documentary filmmakers. Because there wasn't or recently a market in stills photography. And yeah, they can be turned into marketable art photographs. And the great thing about documentaries is that, you know, my friend Ben Lewis did a debate in Hong Kong about whether art belonged to the 5% or not. He makes very good docs too. And the great thing about documentaries is they can never be part of the 5%. They're sort of, like I said, they're a wild card. They have plebeian qualities. They have democratic qualities. And they're practically unmonetizable, which is hell for those who make it, but great for the rest of us. So,
has anyone explored the possibility of a subscription channel on the internet for documentaries?
Why don't you? I would love to. I mean, I just need to be. Yeah, I think it's a great idea. Yeah. Yeah.
You could use the BBC name, but it might even attract some private money and foundation money.
Well, Anne, I think we should have conversations about that and sign up to it. No, I think it's non-exclusive as a distribution system and it contains many of these wonderful things, the cost of running it will be so low. And I think it's a viable business model. I think it's a great idea, and I'd love to do it.
I have a question, which I suppose is about the title of this talk.
Yeah.
And I suppose it's like people make documentaries because they feel strongly about an issue and they probably want to change something.
No, I don't think that's why they make documentaries, but never mind.
Okay, well, that could be the first question.
Was that
a
question?
The second question would be, have you ever seen a change come about as a result of a documentary, and what's the most striking one you've seen?
Well, this is name-dropping. I was on a panel with Robert Redford, and although he signed up to We Change the World, he could not name a documentary that had changed anything. I would answer the question two ways. I think if you go back in time, and we are sitting in Granada or the BBC in the 70s, and you look at the sheer volume of documentaries that are made, shall we say, from a kind of social democratic One Britain perspective, the assumption of which, at its best in Granada, was that you held the state to account for its numerous incompetences, and the BBC was less bold about doing that, then I think over a period of time, they've had a huge but unquantifiable impact. I think that the 7-Up series, it is inconceivable to me, and I should have mentioned it earlier, that this wonderful series did not have an impact in the broadest way about the way certain groups of British people looked at each other and understood their life. I mean, it's such an important series, you know, but I think even if you look at the Al Gore film, the what's it called, The Unacceptable Truth? Inconvenient Truth. Anyway, I got it wrong. There are certain people who say that although the figures, which are on, it's all on the internet, that people polled afterwards and they said, I changed my mind about global warming. There's another group of people who said that even that film that reached many, many millions of people because of Al Gore, because Al Gore was someone that they made a date with, actually only reached people inside the progressive bubble. So I would be skeptical about this. I think in a way, if you're talking about changing things, that they some of the best documentaries operate at a kind of micro level. They reach a few people, and they reach them so powerfully that these few people who are important are impelled to do something. Now, there's a film coming out that I urge you to tell the BBC to buy it, called The Law in These Parts, which is about the operation of Israeli military courts in the occupied territories. And it contains nothing but Israeli judges who spent their lives seconded to a system of military justice, doling out inequitable justice to Palestinians. And I would cheerfully anticipate the viewership for this, when I hope it's shown on BBC4, will be very, very small indeed. But the film has had an enormous impact already, because it's shown to groups of people throughout Israel, and it forces people to look at their lives. I think a lot of the Granada films, the best world actions, were like that. I mean, they reached large audiences because there was no choice at that time. But probably their impact was among small groups of people in a position to do something, because they're in a position of influence. And in that sense, changing the world through documentaries is like changing the world through journalism. You know, it's very difficult, but you can do it from time to time. The Law in These Parts.
Right. Two things, really. Back to how to get some more money, or some way of getting money out of it, or making better documentaries, or getting people together and finding more funds. I think maybe it's a good idea to learn from the Scandinavians and the way they got together to make these very interesting serials, thrillers, Dutch and Swedish, which are very much like almost documentary.
What, like The Killing, you mean? Yeah.
Not only, of course. It's not the only one. There's so many now. I don't know where to start. The Wallander, let's say. And they became a phenomenon. They have a global reach. And I think what they did very cleverly, it was getting together, getting their means together, and the funds together, and doing those things. And it became easier and easier to make better and better things. Maybe organizing people like that.
I think that would be down to you lot, not me. But I do think we are always, it's very interesting, Denmark, because they're always entertaining delegations of BBC executives who come and tell them how to commission things. And in fact, I'll tell you that their system is much more efficient than ours. And if you want to know, an exemplary organization is the Danish Film Institute. It has a record, puts us to shame, of putting out very good fiction films and extremely good documentaries. And it's just, they're very well organized. And I think what you are getting at in Scandinavia is that they have a habit of working well together. And I would think of one thing we could do in this country. I mean, we don't join up the dots. The BFI does what it's doing. The BBC does what it's doing, Channel 4 what it's doing, does what it's doing, and there's no joining up at all. There's no coherent collaboration. There's just people occasionally having meetings and talking to each other. And I don't think in this country it's very bad for movements in this country. We're not good at that. But if we could become a little more Scandinavian in this and many other instances too, that would be a huge plus. I agree.
Yeah, I wanted to ask about the BBC, which is currently being forced to cut something like 20% from its overall budget. And I wondered if you felt, or how you felt, this might impact on the production and distribution of documentaries.
Well, we are okay at Storyville because we had cuts. They cut our number of titles about 3 years ago. So we're okay till the middle of, beginning of 2014. Seems like a long way ahead, but it isn't. And I just make two points. Firstly, I think that factual programs and documentaries, you know, what the BBC does well, they're not going to abandon them. But I do see a possibility that everything will get squeezed in the same way as everything else is being squeezed at the BBC. I think it won't be easy. But I think, relatively speaking, I think the BBC is in a better position than all these other broadcasters. Like, I promise you, Canadian broadcasting, am I going to say this? Yes. If they had tried to destroy documentaries, they could not have done it more effectively. I mean, you know, you you have really, and not just in Canada, you have really quite astonishing self-removal from the field of documentaries by organizations that until quite recently revered them. And I don't understand this. It seems to me a form of vandalism that I'll never understand. But it's not at the BBC, but I think you have to be vigilant and you have to hope for the best.
Thank you very, very much indeed for some very thought-provoking comments. I can assure you that I and my former colleagues from when I worked in Bosnia, post-Bosnian War, are committed Storyville people, because the recent dramatized documentary on the love of books, my interpreter played the lead female part in that. So I'm now, we're all convinced Storyville people. But my question is perhaps leading on from several comments of your own and from some of the questioners about getting it commercial. What are your views on running something that you'd frankly prefer not to do but will sell as a lead-in to getting really provocative or attention-grabbing on the basis of immediate follow-up from that, which it might not, they might not get if they were standalone?
Oh, I'd be quite a tart about these things. If, you know, if it's going to get ratings, you'll put it on. And I think you've got to think, you know, if it's going on Storyville, is it a good film, but is it going to be popular? I think we could do with more popular subjects. I think if I have one piece of advice for documentary filmmakers is try to think big, try to get the money together and do more popular things. I mean, we have in development a film about the American comedian Richard Pryor. I mean, you know, it took us a long time to get to make this film dealing with his family, but I would envisage that the ratings would be quite high on that. The ratings for Man on Wire were high, but over 2 million seems to me to be pretty good. It's about what Robert Peston gets, you know, on BBC Two, and that's, you're not going to get much higher than that. You're not going to get much higher than that. It's self-evidently more difficult to get. Peston's on the news the whole time. There's a certain name recognition. People are terrified about the prospect of the euro collapsing. So that's, I learned today on BBC Radio, that's what he got. So no, I would want higher ratings. I would want more films to be in peak time on BBC Two. It's mystifying to me why certain films that are popular are not put over the weekends on BBC Two, because God knows there isn't a huge amount to watch always over the weekends, and they belong there. They are, we could do with more entertaining films with a gloss on them, but that doesn't mean they can't be good films too. I mean, did anyone see the film about Valentino, about the two wonderful queens who ran the Couture House Valentino? It was very, very funny. It was wonderful, and you know, more films like that would be a good idea. You don't have to have somber films the whole time about massacres.
That wasn't marketed.
Valentino. Well, nothing is marketed. I have no marketing budget.
And that's part of the issue.
It is, but one of the problems about documentaries is they're one-offs, and one-offs are the hardest thing to market, as we know. You know.
And it's not celebrity now.
No. But those are all the reasons that they're good. I mean, you wouldn't want to spend all. You have to find a way of telling people when you don't want things that are heavily marketed, you don't want celebrities, you go here, and you'll find something else. And it's possible, but it's difficult. And this is the real problem in television. It's not actually that these people running television, whoever they are, they may not exist, in fact, it just runs itself. They don't want to do things that are difficult. And promoting documentaries is more difficult than commissioning stuff in runs of 100. Yes, why? Or that, I don't know.
Well, I just wanted to ask about who drives your audience and whether you have a kind of regular Storyville audience or if it's a particular film that gets the big numbers, and whether things like Twitter, like if you get a tweet from someone with a lot of followers directing people towards the iPlayer, how much influence that has on how many views you get.
Well, I think it's very hard to know who the Storyville audience is, except anecdotally, because we've always, for the last 6 years, we've been on a digital channel, and the programs fluctuate. I mean, I'll tell you, because we don't have any marketing budget, because we're not trailed at the BBC, realistically, the only way we can push the ratings up is a very simple way. It has to do with something called the Electronic Program Guide, aka the EPG. And we had some shows after Newsnight, i.e. 11 o'clock at night, and the first film was called Sex, Death and the Gods. Right, the audience clocks in at 450,000, so we think, oh, shit, that's wonderful. The next film was about the kidnapping of the heiress, Patty Hearst, and a stunning film, but we omitted to change the title, and it was called Gorilla. Okay, the audience dips to a lamentable level, so Kate and I start panicking, so all the titles, we change all the titles, and every one of them has sex, cannibals, whatever in them. The ratings go up again.
Yeah. It's still photography. And it's the same thing in a multimedia environment. We've got the hijacking of the narrow casting of what the wide audience is looking for. And whether it's a Beckham's pecs and his whatever, yeah, and his wife's breasts, well, bigger or smaller.
Well, we inhabit this world. What can we do, you know? Make the best of it.
Yeah, I mean, is there a particular fund out there anywhere in the world that is dedicated to documentaries? And if there isn't, I guess there isn't, there are a staggering amount of high net worth individuals who like, yeah, to give to charity. Well, and if documentaries don't make money, it doesn't matter as long as they're funded and they get their audience that wants to see them. And maybe, well, that, yes, is the way forward.
Well, I go into this in some degree. I try and give you a quick answer to that because it ultimately gets quite upsetting. There are a great number of high worth individuals, and they divide up into two camps. There's some like groups of lawyers, like Taxi to the Dark Side, that was probably the best deeply disturbing film about the torture of American army in, you know, it was in Bagram, it was in Afghanistan. That was funded by a small group of lawyers. You get people in America coming together to do that. There's another lateral development, which is distinctly more alarming, and that is the creation of sort of funds by people who wish to change the world. I mean, I don't think guilt is a very strong animating factor among the very rich, but sort of feeling better about yourself is. And the tendency, not always, but just sometimes, the tendency is it makes life actually more difficult for people like me, because you can't go to these people and say, look, you must fund this documentary because it's a wonderful documentary. When Claude Lanzmann went around groups of rich Jewish people trying to find money to finish off Shoah, and by the way, the money came, you know, the biggest check came from the French president. François Mitterrand wrote him a huge check. So Shoah was basically funded by the French state. He'd go to these meetings and they'd say, what's the message of this film? And what they meant is, if I sit through 9 hours of your film, am I going to feel better at the end of it? And he said, no, there isn't a message. So nobody gave him any money. And I think you have to remember that. There's a kind of packaging of social action. And I hate to be cynical about this. It's usually collections of people who would dread the consequence of any upheaval in the world. I mean, giving money to documentaries becomes a substitute activity. You know, I think Jean-Paul Sartre was like that. He banged on about Third World Revolution, but he would have been horrified if it had actually happened. You know, he hadn't been able to go to his cafe down the road and or pop his Benzedrines or whatever it was that killed him, you know. And I think, reluctantly, that many of these foundations are like Jean-Paul Sartre in the cafe. They'll give you money for something, but they don't want any consequences, but they just pretend they do. And I think this is a contemporary phenomenon far more fascinating in a way than the funding of documentaries. And I wish I could write about it, but for obvious reasons, I can't.
Just take two more questions.
One thing you didn't haven't really discussed is the cinematic aspect of these films, and the I think there's been a really creative period for nonfiction in general. I mean, radio and starting with One Day in September, which it seems like documentaries have been much more influenced by feature films.
Well, no, I think it's the other way around.
You
actually
think it's the other way,
yeah,
around?
Yeah, I do.
You don't think that they wanted to start making films that with three-act structures, with...
No, I know it's all bollocks, all three-act structures.
Yeah, yeah, but you don't think that's been an influence?
No, I hate all that stuff. I can't bear it, you know. When people say to me, what's the narrative arc of this film? I say, no, thank you. I feel don't want to talk about it.
It's around and about in documentary world. People see some films...
I think some of the worst documentaries are those which are made to look
Spelling
like...
Bees.
Oh, no, I thought that was wonderful. But that just was a wonderful story, and it was very charming, and the characters were great and all that. But, no, I think the Bourne films are unthinkable without Granada Television. Mm. I mean, the primary influence on the Bourne inheritance is World in Action. Mm. You know, all those cameras swinging all over the place, the out-of-focus stuff, the simulacrum of reality, and what favours documentaries have done to rich people. And it's never been reciprocated.
Yeah, hello. I'd just like to point out that, you know, there's been a recurring theme that you mentioned that you didn't think there was an easy way to mass distribute documentaries. There's technology coming down the line, 4G, LTE, that will be with us in a very short period of time that will remove that road. That roadblock that many people here have mentioned. It's been mentioned that people have got digital channels where there's a toll gate in place, but that toll gate won't be there for much longer.
No, I quite agree with that, but I think on the whole, technology is only good as the uses to which it's put, and unless you have institutions and organisation and capability, unless you have a system for showing the films, distributing the films, collecting the money, making people aware they exist, you will still have the same problems as we have now. So I wouldn't be at all pessimistic, and the potential, as you say, is enormous, though I don't know about this system, but I think you have to think more about the method of distribution.
Thank you, everybody, for coming, and thank you, Nick Fraser.